Welcome to the Good Growing Podcast. I am Ken Johnson, horticulture educator with University of Illinois Extension, coming to you today from Jacksonville, Illinois, with a Garden Bite. And on this week's Garden Bite, we're going to talk a little bit about milkweeds and some of the different insects we can find feeding on them besides monarch caterpillars. So milkweeds have become a popular garden plant in the last several years, primarily because people have been planting these to support monarch butterflies, because milkweed is going to be the sole food source for monarch caterpillars. Milkweeds contain toxic compounds, and these are cardiac glycosides, and the plants have these to deter animals from feeding on them, like insects and mammals. However, monarchs have evolved to be able to feed on these plants, and additionally, monarchs can take these chemicals and incorporate them into their bodies, which is going to make them unpalatable to other animals. So if you grow milkweed and you've ever gone out and checked your plants for monarch caterpillars, you may have been surprised to find other insects living and feeding on your milkweed plants. After all, they are toxic to other animals. However, there are some other insects that have evolved to be able to feed on milkweed, and, like monarch caterpillars, some of them have become milkweed specialists. So some of the different animals, or some of the different insects we can find feeding on milkweed include, there's several different species of longhorn beetles. One of the most commonly found one is going to be the red milkweed beetle. And the adults of these are bright red, and they have black spots, and they have long antennae. That's the longhorn beetle name. And they're about half an inch long. And if you ever pick these up, the adults will squeak when disturbed, which is kind of interesting if you ever try this out. The adults are going to feed on the leaves, buds, and flowers of the plants. And when they're going to be feeding, and when they feed on leaves, they're going to cut the leaf veins below the area where they're going to start feeding. And this is going to cause the latex from the leaves to drain out, so it doesn't gum up their mouth parts. Females are going to lay their eggs near the base of milkweed plants, and when the eggs hatch, the larvae are going to burrow in to and eat the stems and roots of the plant. The larvae are going to overwinter in the roots before pupating, and then they'll pupate in the spring. The adults are going to emerge early in the summer, right about when milkweeds begin to bloom, and the cycle will continue. One cool thing about red milkweed beetle is their eyes. So the genus they belong to, the Tetraopes, comes from the Greek tetra, meaning four, and ops, meaning eye. So the eyes of these insects have actually been divided into two by their antennae. So it makes it look like they have four eyes. So if you ever find some of these, pick them up, see if they'll squeak for you, and check out their eyes. Another type of beetle we can commonly find on milkweeds here in Illinois is going to be the swamp milkweed leaf beetle. And as their name implies, they prefer swamp or rose milkweed, but they will also feed another species of milkweed too. Like the red milkweed beetles, the adults and the larvae, in the swamp milkweed leaf beetle case, they're also going to cut the veins of the milkweed before feeding on them. The adults of the swamp milkweed leaf beetle are dome-shaped. They have a black head and pronotum, and that's that area behind the head, the pronotum. Their elytra, or the wing covers, are going to be yellow to orange, and they're going to have black to dark blue markings on them. The larvae are going to be gray to orange with a row of black spots along their sides. When the larvae are fully grown, they're going to drop to the ground and pupate, and then they're going to emerge as adults in the fall, and they'll start feeding, and then they'll overwinter in plant debris, usually near the base of milkweed plants or in the soil. And then the adults will emerge in the spring, they'll lay eggs, and the cycle will resume. There are a couple different species of true bugs, or insects in the order Hemiptera, that can also be found feeding on milkweed. We have the large and small milkweed bugs. So adult large milkweed bugs are about 3/4 inch long, orange to reddish orange, and they have a black band across their back. The nymphs and the adults are going to feed on milkweed, particularly the seeds, and they're going to be commonly found clustering on the seed pods of plants. And monarchs are famous for their migration down in the eastern half of the United States, down into Mexico, where they overwinter. And large milkweed bugs will also migrate. They also travel south for the winter. So when temperatures begin to cool, days start getting shorter, the adults are going to start migrating south. Eventually, they end up in the southern Atlantic and Gulf Coast states, and they're going to spend the winter there. And as temperatures begin to warm in the spring, those large milkweed bug populations will begin their journey back north. The small milkweed bugs are also orange and black, but instead of a black bar on their back, they have kind of a heart-shaped patch on their back, along with two black patches on either side of that. Additionally, as their name implies, they're going to be smaller than large milkweed beetles, or large milkweed bugs, about half an inch long. In addition to feeding on their preferred food source, which is milkweed seeds, they may also feed on other plants, feed on nectar from flowers, and occasionally they may feed on other insects when food is scarce. Unlike large milkweed bugs, small milkweed bugs are going to be permanent residents here in Illinois. They do not migrate at all. There are also other caterpillars we can find on milkweed plants. So we have the milkweed tussock moth, and the newly hatched caterpillars are going to be pale and hairless with black heads. And when they're young, we often will find these feeding in large groups. They're gregarious, and they're going to feed in between the veins of the milkweed leaves, and it'll cause them to have a skeletonized appearance. So familiar with what Japanese beetle damage looks like, it's going to be similar damage to that caused by these tussock moths. As they develop through the different instars, they become covered with tufts of black, white, and orange hairs. The larger caterpillars are going to cut the veins of the leaves, again, to reduce the amount of latex in the leaves. And this is going to allow them to consume entire leaves of the plants they're feeding on. As they get larger, they also start to wander away from the groups that they've been feeding on, and you'll often find them feeding alone or in pairs, not in large groups anymore. Populations get really high of these caterpillars. They are capable of defoliating milkweed plants. So if you're concerned with the milkweed tussock moth eating all your milkweed plants and leaving no foliage for your monarchs, don't be too alarmed. Milkweed tussock moths, the caterpillars tend to favor older foliage, while monarchs tend to prefer younger foliage. So they're not necessarily competing for the same resources there. When caterpillars of the tussock moths are fully grown, they're going to drop to the ground and spin a gray cocoon, and they will then pupate. The adult moths are kind of nondescript. They have gray wings. However, when they lift those up, you can see their orange abdomen is going to have black spots. And the tussock moths, they're going to lay their eggs in large masses on the underside of leaves, unlike monarchs, which usually lay their eggs singly. Last insect we'll talk about is going to be oleander aphids, and these are probably the ones that people have the most questions about when they find these on their milkweed plants. So these are these bright yellow aphids that have black legs and cornicles, and these are little tube-like projections off the backside of the aphids. They are native to the Mediterranean region of the world, and their primary host is oleander, which happens to be in the same family as milkweed. Females reproduce without mating, so they can do parthenogenesis. So basically, they're giving birth to live clones of themselves. They don't lay any eggs, which means their populations are capable of growing very quickly. Like other aphids, they're often found on the clusters of new growth. There'll be new leaves, flowers, things like that. And they have straw-like mouthparts, and they're going to suck the sap from the plants, kind of like a juice box. And if you have a lot of them, excessive feeding can cause plants to be stunted, cause them to become deformed, twisted, and things like that. And additionally, they're going to produce honeydew, which can lead to the development of sooty mold, which is a black fungus that'll grow on that honeydew. Doesn't directly hurt the plant. It's not growing on the plants or infecting it. It's growing on that honeydew, but that can block sunlight and reduce photosynthesis. So a lot of times when people are growing milkweed for monarchs, they aren't particularly excited or happy to find other insects feeding on their milkweed plants. However, all of these insects, with the exception of the oleander aphids, are native to the United States and have been feeding on milkweed with monarchs for a very long time. This has been happening for thousands and millions of years. Out of all the insects, oleander aphids are probably the only ones you would consider pests, or that should be really considered pests, that may need some sort of management. Oftentimes with aphids, you can just spray them off with a strong stream of water. However, if you do this, you do run the risk of removing small monarch caterpillars or other insects from those plants as well. Fortunately, as with other aphids, natural enemies like ladybugs, lacewings, surfeit flies, parasitoid wasps will often come in and manage populations and get them under control. Insecticides could be used. Again, not really recommended because any insecticides you apply to your plants are also going to affect monarchs and all the other insects feeding on them as well. So generally do not recommend applying insecticides to your milkweed. So instead of being concerned about the presence of these other insects, we should be happy that we're providing an environment that is suitable for them to thrive as well. Just remember, they depend on milkweed just as much as the monarchs do. That's all I've got for you for this week's Garden Bite. Hopefully you've learned a little bit about some of the different insects we can find on our milkweed. Thank you for doing what you do best, and that is listening, or if you're watching us on YouTube, watching. And as always, keep on growing.